people feel like the creator, the whole energy, and the first people feeling the peace should be there.
There's recent results that we have obtained by reinvestigating the 19-4-ion Pα0 reaction at low bombarding energies in connection with the study of the spectroscopy of the neon 20 compound nucleus. The reaction constitutes one of the most long-standing story in nuclear physics, in nuclear physics field. In fact, the first signature of the possible transmutation of fluorine induced by low energy protons was found already by Cockcroft and Walton during the 30s of the previous century. Common Gibbons reported in the Proceedings of the Royal Society collected the first comprehensive studies of these reactions as a function of the bombarding energy, so but at just one fixed angles, and so the first experimental excitation functions were found for the alpha particles and the alpha gamma channels. 2 years after, there was the observation by Straib, Fowler and Lauritsen reported in the Physical Review that extended the previous results of Buchan and Gibbons. This kind of studies were performed also during the 40s, 50s and 60s, but it was during the 70s that this subject show a renewed interest in the scientific community, because during the 70s there were a lot of developments of cluster-like models, such as the quartet models that was introduced by Arima, Gillet and Ginocchio, and also by the standard cluster model introduced by Ikeda and collaborators. In this kind of models, it is quite interesting to look at the behavior of the neon 20 nucleus, because neon 20 has carbon 12, oxygen 16 and so on, is a self-conjugated nucleus, so a typical nucleus that is constituted by multiplets of alpha particles, that can be seen as multiplets of alpha particles. Anyway, so even if there were strong experimental efforts to investigate these two reactions that can give us access to the spectroscopy of the neon 20, that is populated as compound nucleus, there were many ambiguities that are still persisting in the spectroscopy of this interesting nucleus, especially at excitation energies that are around 13 MeV per nucleon. In this excitation energy region, there are many models predict the possible existence of cluster states, such as this 2-1-1 cluster quartet state that should be located at around 13.3 MeV. This kind of alpha cluster states should show a total width that is more or less equal, similar to the alpha partial width, and a reduced width for the alpha pi channels that should be quite larger than the reduced width for the alpha zero channel. So, if we make some diagrams of the possible reactions that can be obtained by investigating the proton plus 19 fluorine reaction in the low energy bombarding domain, clearly the main dominant mechanism is the compound nucleus formation, and so you can populate the compound nucleus states at around from 13 up to 14, 15 MeV and so on, but this excited state can be excited by emitting alpha particles. So if the alpha particles left the residual nucleus, the oxygen 16, in the ground state, this channel is called alpha 0, while if the oxygen 16 is left to the first excited state, this channel is typically indicated as alpha pi, because this state is a pi emitting state. The other transition are called as usual alpha 1, 2 and 3. The point is that this 6.05 MeV second 0 plus state in the oxygen 16 is a state characterized by having a strong cluster nature, as testified in many papers in the literature, and therefore this transition leading to the alpha pi transition leading to the emission of an alpha particles and left the residual nucleus in the 6.05 MeV state can be a signature of the possible existence of a cluster structure in the parent nucleus, and from this consideration it follows that if these relations between the partial and the reduced width are verified, that state in the compound nucleus can be assigned as a cluster state. It seems that can be described in terms of cluster excitation. The problem is that in this excitation energy involved, where the possible existence of this state is claimed by many models, there are many ambiguities in the spectroscopy of this compound nucleus. There are another point for which this reaction is extremely important, that is the astrophysical point, because this reaction play an important role in the astrophysical domain, being involved in the CNO cycle. These reactions, the 1949 P alpha in general, are in fact involved in the fourth branch of the CNO cycle. Moreover, recently it has been pointed out that this reaction can be an important channel for the destruction of fluorine into the stars. And this is an important problem because in modern astrophysics, the fluorine nucleosynthesis is still an open question. So, for these two reasons, we decided to reinvestigate this reaction, for which there are many ambiguities in the reported literature, profiting of the possibility of using our small accelerator in Naples. So, just a few words about the ambiguities reported in the literature for the spectroscopy of the neon 20, as I said before. If we look at this table that is taken from the classical compilation by Tilley et al. That collects the spectroscopic studies for light nuclei, mass 20 nuclei, you can find that there are many ambiguities in the resonances that are observed in this reaction. For example, the existence of two states at bombarding energies around 400 keV is only supposed. There are many ambiguities for these two states. And for example, for the state at 710 keV, this J-pi assignment is only tentative. And the most important ambiguities, anyway, is associated to the 842 keV state that was so ambiguously assigned J-pi equal 0 plus or 2 plus into two different works, and two very different sets of reduced and partial width are reported in the literature for this resonance. There are ambiguities also in the absolute value of the cross-section, of the integrated cross-section, as pointed out some years ago by the NACRE collaboration. In fact, they collected the data available in the literature for this reaction, the absolute and the direct data, and as you can see, there are only three datasets that explore the low energy, the low bombarding energy, and the center of mass energy domain. So the direct data by Breuer that are in blue are the 40% larger, around 40% larger than the green data that are data taken from the paper by Isoia that have been normalized to higher energy resonances. And so it seems that in the lowermost center of mass energy involved, there is this strong ambiguity between the two datasets that is reflected in an ambiguity for the astrophysical factor, obviously, that is obtained starting from this integrated cross-section evaluation. The ambiguities between these two datasets by Breuer and Isoia at the lowermost center of mass energy is responsible for a strong ambiguity in the extrapolation of the astrophysical factor down to the energies of stellar interest. And this ambiguity in the non-resonating part of the astrophysical factor leads to strong ambiguities in the reaction rate determination for this kind of reaction. It is nice to underline that there are strong ambiguities also for the alpha pi channel. In this case, the experimental investigation is extremely difficult because the alpha pi channels involve one of the two states that are very close lying in the oxygen 16 scheme, and so it is extremely difficult. You need a very good resolution experiment to perform this kind of investigation. Anyway, only these three datasets are reported in the literature, and the strong ambiguities in the absolute normalization are observed up to a factor of 2. For all this reason, we decided to perform a new experiment in Naples, where we have a small tabletop tandem, so at our physics department. Here is a picture of our small tandem and of the control room. And we decided that as a first point to investigate the 19-prime P alpha 0 reaction. So in order to choose the optimum detection system, we decided clearly we performed as a first investigation the study of the kinematics of the 19-prime P alpha 0 reaction and the kinematics of the elastic scattering channel. As you can see, there's cubes that correlates the alpha energy with the emission angle in the lab frame. Due to the strong Q value of this reaction, the alpha particles have energies very large at all angles investigated, going from around 6.6 MeV at the backwardmost angles and for 0.6 MeV bombarding energy up to around 8 MeV kinetic energy for 1 MeV bombarding energies. At variance, the elastic scattering channel is much more, show clearly very low kinetic energies, and so the typical proton energies are around 1 MeV for the forward angles and around 0.5 MeV for the backward angles. So, considering that there's two very different kinetic energy domains shown by the alpha zero channels and the elastic scattering channel, we decided to use the so-called absorber technique. So our detection system was constituted by many silicon pin diodes detectors that were preceded by a thin aluminum foil whose thickness was sufficient to stop completely the elastically and inelastically protons, but their thickness allowed the passing through of the high energy alpha particles. With this method, therefore, we can avoid the strong flux of elastically and inelastically scattered protons, especially at forward angles. The energies are very low, and so the cross-section are quite high for the scattered particles. At variance, the alpha particles are correctly, pass this thin stage of aluminium and can reach safely the detectors and can be registered. So we used inside this ultra-vacuum scattering chamber, we placed different detectors, an array of detectors covering the forward and the backward direction in the reaction plane. So from 20 down to 160 degrees in 10 degree steps. So the bombarding energies was varied from 0.6 to 1 MeV in 10 keV energy step in order to obtain a good description of the excitation functions. As target, we used a lithium fluoride layer that was evaporated on a very thin carbon baking, and the lithium fluoride powder used to be evaporated on this carbon substrate was a lithium 6 fluoride compound enriched in the lithium 6 isotope at the 95% level. Therefore, it still presents a contamination of lithium 7 isotope at the level of 5%, and this contamination can give rise to the lithium 7 P alpha reaction when bombarded with proton. And in fact, if you look at your experimental spectra, you can see at all angles the presence of these two well-separated peaks. The first one, with the larger amplitude, is clearly associated to the 19 fluorine P alpha 0 reaction. The second one to the reaction on the lithium 7 contaminant. The energy of this second peak is quite larger than the first one because of the larger Q value involved in this reaction. Furthermore, we verified this kind of kinematical identification for these two peaks by changing in RAN the used target and by using a barium fluoride target. When we use this barium fluoride target, this second peak completely disappears, while the first peak is still persisting at the same channel position, and this clearly is the resolving the checkpoint for this identification performed with the kinematics. So if we consider the counting, the counts under the peak, and you can see that there is practically no background between the two peaks, we can obtain the yield curve, and we can transform the yield curve in the differential cross-section, taking also into account the energy loss in the target thickness. And as you can see here, is reported excitation function as a function of the angle in the lab frame. You can see clearly that there are many structures in the excitation function. There are peaks that are both broad and narrow. And due to the fact that the vertical scale is fixed for all the spans, you can see that the various peaks show a nice evolution as a function of the angle in the lab frame. If we look at the 150-degree angle, we can observe that our data are here reported in a magnified region as black dots, together with other results reported in the literature at similar angles. The direct data by Puzzocrea et al. At 155 degrees, so at similar angles in the lab frame. In red, the data by Golichev et al. In green, the data by Golichev et al., absolute data. And the blue line represents the data by Dumegar et al., but in this case, the blue data have to be normalized for a normalization factor equal to 1.4 to match the other points. And this normalization factor is in agreement with the other investigation performed when you compare your data with the data by Dumegar et al. As you can see, in our data, the shape of our excitation function is in quite good agreement with the other datasets here reported. So, due to the fact that we have covered the reaction plane with many detectors, we can use the Andra distribution to get information about the compound nucleus spectroscopy. As we know from the literature, the outgoing channel spin for the 19 fluorine P alpha 0 and also for the 19 fluorine P alpha pi reaction is 0. So the outgoing channel spin is 0. Therefore, by applying the simple rules related to the addition of angular momenta, it follows immediately that the spin of the compound nucleus is equal to the orbital angular momentum in the exit channel, in the outgoing channel, that we call here as LF. This LF can be obtained by starting from the experimental data concerning the angular distribution by fitting the angular distributions in terms of cosine and Legendre polynomials. In this case, when you perform the fit, the coefficients of each terms of this polynomial expansion that we call respectively an and bn for the cosine and Legendre polynomial show anomalies in correspondence of a given resonance in the compound nucleus. So the presence of these anomalies for the even coefficients can be immediately related to the LF and therefore to the J of the compound state by using this simple formula that correlates the LF with the order of the resonating polynomial, of the resonating coefficient. So the LF is equal to n, the order of the resonating coefficients, divided by 2. It is also interesting to look at the evolution of the odd coefficients because the presence of anomalies in these odd coefficients is an indication of the possible interference between closed line states having opposite parities. Due to the low center of mass energies involved in this experiment, we can truncate our series up to the D wave, so L equal 2 is involved, and at this point can be simply verified just by performing some semi-classical calculation and also by looking at the literature for which only D waves are assumed as a maximum order for this series of cosine and Legendre polynomials. And therefore we can truncate our series of polynomials up to the n equal 4 order. This kind of analysis has been used in the past by many collaborations to perform the investigation of this of the spectroscopy of main of a lot of nuclei. And an example of of this technique applied to the 19 fluorine P alpha pi reaction is taken from the very old but interesting paper by Isoia of 1958. Here I show as full dots the experimental angular distributions that we achieved. Here the angular distribution are shown as a function of the cosinus of the center of mass angle, and clearly the vertical scale is given as a millibar per steradian in the center of mass system. The thick lines are the fit, the polynomial fit, and the dotted line corresponds to the confidence band at the 95% level of the fit procedure. In the three-dimensional plot, I show the evolution of the fitted angular distribution as a function of the bombarding energy in the region between 0.7 and around 0.9 MeV. So I have to stress that the use of the absorber technique allow us to have good quality angular distributions also at forward angles, and therefore to obtain a good quality fit of these angular distributions. So the evolution of the AN and BN coefficients as a function of the bombarding energy is here reported for the two set, for the two procedure of fitting in terms of polynomial of cosinus of the center of mass angle or by using the Legendre polynomials. And you can see clearly, for example, that in this energy region that corresponds to the resonance at 0.842 keV, for which the two ambiguous Jebye assignments have been performed, we can see clearly that there is a resonant behavior of the black coefficient, that is the A0 coefficient, and correspondingly also the B0 coefficient here is resonating. And therefore it seems that this state should be assigned as 0+. Moreover, it is interesting to observe that at slightly lower bombarding energy, there is a peak in the red coefficient, as you can see, that are the A2 and B2 coefficient. So it seems that there is a closed lying state at slightly lower excitation energies that is characterized by having a 1- behavior. It is also nice to observe the presence of anomalies, of negative anomalies, in the odd term, such as the green term, that is an indication of the presence of interference between these two states having the opposite parities. The presence of this doublet is also, has been also tentatively induced in this very old test two different resonances for the A0 and the A2 coefficient that are very close lying, and so this is a tentative indication of the presence of this doublet state with opposite parities. And the presence of these two close lying states is also confirmed if you look at the excitation function taken by Dumedar et al. At 150 degrees. This excitation function is obtained in a very fine energy step, and you can see that in the rising part of the structure observed at around 0.84 MeV, the rising part of this structure shows two different slopes, and therefore this difference of slopes can be associated with the presence of a broad state superimposed to the higher state at higher excitation energy. So it seems that there is an agreement between our new investigation and some tentative observation performed in the past. So by analyzing the various anomalies that are observed at various energy, we can finally obtain this table in which we collect the J-pi assignment that can be done for the various states observed at various bombarding energies. So resolving at least the ambiguities for the energy region at around 842 keV, but also confirming previously performed spin parity assignment for these two states, and also for this very low energy state, peaked at around 650 keV, for which this J-pi assignment was performed tentatively only in just one paper in the literature, and we confirm this assignment with our data. So profiting of the angular distributions that we have achieved, we can get easily the integrated cross section and the astrophysical factor. Our data are reported as black stars with error bars, and as you can see, our data are in quite good agreement with the data set by Isoy et al. Normalized and by Caraccio et al. In green for the energy region around the resonance at 0.8 MeV in the center of mass, corresponding to 0.842 MeV in the laboratory frame. While in the lowermost energy, bombarding energy and center of mass energy domain, the shape of our data is more or less similar to the data by Isoy et al. Normalized that are reported here in blue. But the absolute normalization is more similar to the direct data that are reported in the paper by Breuer of 1959. This point is extremely interesting because it seems that with these findings we have to increase the absolute normalization of the lowermost energy region and by a factor around 1.4. And this increase in the absolute normalization is important when you perform the extrapolation of the astrophysical factor down to the energy of the stellar interest. Moreover, it is interesting to see that the data by Breuer in red show these two points that seems to be related to the existence of a very broad state or two broad states peaked at around 0.4 MeV. This claimed existence of these resonances was computed, was doubtful because it was never seen before, and therefore it can be extremely interesting to perform a new experiment to aim at exploring the lowermost energy domain as possible, so at least the energy region between 0.3 and 0.4 MeV, in order to solve these ambiguities related to the existence or not of these two states. Moreover, our data, our direct data in this bombarding energy region can be used also to improve the absolute normalization that indirect method had to perform in their astrophysical factor cures in order to get the absolute value of the astrophysical factor, and so they can be very useful to improve the determination of the astrophysical factor down to the stellar energy that can be obtained with the indirect method also. Just to conclude my talk, we can solve also the ambiguity for the structure of the 0.842 MeV state, for which two different partial Wiedit sets have been reported in the literature. In this bombarding energy region, the open channels are the elastic scattering, clearly, and the inelastic scattering on the target on the first and second excited state of the 19 fluorine, the alpha zero channel, as I showed you before, the alpha pi channel, and also the alpha gamma channel is open, but due to reasons involving the parity, due to rules involving the parity, the resonance is excited in the alpha zero and alpha pi channels are different, have different parities respect to the resonance excited with the alpha gamma channels, and therefore these channels can be discarded in our analysis. So I said before that at 842 keV there are two different sets of reduced width involving the proton alpha zero and alpha pi channels, and by investigating our integrated cross-section in terms of a resonating background and Lorentzian-like functions, each one described in the presence of a given state, we can obtain the contribution that is shown here as a blue line for the 842 keV state in millibar, and this contribution can be useful to get information on the partial width for the P0 and the alpha zero channels in the Breit-Wigner assumption. The Breit-Wigner formula has to be solved by using this value for the cross section, and the problem is that the Breit-Wigner equation is a 2-degree, it's an equation of second degree, and therefore give us two different solutions for the P0 channel. We have to get to use the largermost gamma P0 evaluation value that is around the total width for this state, around 23 keV, because a prominent resonance is seen in the scattering of a proton on 19 fluorine at this bombarding energy. At variance, if we look at the alpha particle scattering on oxygen 16 target at a bombarding energy corresponding to the excitation of the same state in the compound nucleus, you cannot observe any resonances, any anomalies in the differential cross-section at backward angles. Therefore, it seems reasonable to assume that the largermost part of the partial width is absorbed by the P0 channel. With this reasonable assumption, we can estimate immediately in this work the alpha zero partial width that is estimated to be around 48 electron volt plus or minus 8 electron volt. And we can use the dataset by Caraccio to have an idea about, even if rough, about the partial width for the alpha pi channel. This is of the similar order of magnitude. We finally can transform the partial width into reduced width expressed as a function of the Wigner limit, and you found that for the elastic scattering reduced width, it covers only the 10% of the Wigner limit, that is a reasonable quantity of this limits, and in the case of the alpha 0 and alpha pi channel, the percentage of the limit of the Wigner limit is much lower, of the order of 10 to the minus 3 and 10 to the minus 2. And therefore, this state, even if for this state the reduced width is for the alpha pi channel is larger than the reduced width for the alpha 0 channel, this state cannot be associated, cannot be said to have a strong alpha structure, because the total width is similar to the P0 reduced to partial width and not to the alpha 0 plus alpha gamma reduced width. This kind of investigation can be performed also for lower bombarding energy resonances, even if in this case there are very few experimental data on the elastic and inelastic scattering. And this lack of data is a pity, because we can. It would be very useful to solve these ambiguities of nuclear structure for also for the states in the compound orders neon 20. I conclude this kind of this presentation also by pointing out that we are thinking to perform a new experiment in Lagnar next year in order to investigate this bombarding energy region, in order to fix this, to obtain data for in the bombarding energy region where very few data are reported in the literature, in order to fix the problems related to the spectroscopy of this nucleus. So thank you for your attention.